Good evening, everyone. Welcome. My name is Paul O'Neill. On behalf of Kingston's Buried Treasures, we'd like to welcome you here tonight to our fifth installment of our lecture series. The subject tonight is Thomas Cornell, Vanderbilt of the Rondout. And the comparison of Thomas Cornell to Cornelius Vanderbilt is appropriate. Much like Cornelius Vanderbilt, Thomas Cornell dominated practically every industry in our area during his lifetime. While he's most closely associated with the steamship and towing industry, he was a powerhouse in the bluestone industry, the cement industry, railroads, even the Catskill Hotels with his grand hotel in Highmount. So he's quite an individual, and he really is what we are talking about with this series of Kingston's Buried Treasures. It really is mind-boggling to me that Thomas Cornell, who was such a dominant force during his lifetime, has become relatively unknown to us today. So he really is a perfect example of what we're trying to do with this lecture series. And we are very, very privileged tonight to have as our featured speaker, Stuart Murray. Stuart is a noted author and has written over 40 books. The subjects of these books range from Norman Rockwell to the story of the song Yankee Doodle, which, by the way, is an incredibly interesting story. I recommend you get his book if you can. But the book we're talking about tonight is this book, Thomas Cornell and the Cornell Steamboat Company. And to my knowledge, it's the only book written about Thomas Cornell. So we are very fortunate to have Stuart Murray here today. And I'm going to briefly read a short portion of the foreword written by Stuart Murray because I think it typifies exactly what we're trying to do with this series. For generations, the Cornell Steamboat Company's whistles were heard and recognized from the northern canals to New York Harbor. But the names of Thomas Cornell and S.D. Kirkendall, who was Thomas Cornell's son-in-law and later took over the company from him, have been forgotten even in Kingston, the city they helped build in the mid-Hudson Valley. What Cornell and Kirkendall achieved with such brilliance is virtually unknown to the descendants of hundreds of men and women who worked for them, competed with them, envied them, and surely admired them. It would be gratifying if this book helps renew interest in the Cornell Steamboat Company and in the people and boats who made Cornell one of the finest and most enduring business enterprises America's ever known. I couldn't say it better myself. I couldn't even say it nearly as good. So without further ado, it's my privilege to introduce Stuart Murray.
Thank you, Paul. I'm told I have to watch out and stay between these two mics. I'll do my best. I'm really glad to be here and privileged to be here. I haven't given a lot of talks in the last few years, and when this book came out in 2001, hard to believe, I had the three people who were behind this book to begin with. Bill Spangenberger, who was the last president of Cornell Steamboat Company, Roger Mabee from Port Ewan, I'm sure a lot of you know Roger, and Barry Thomas. And so if I had to give a talk, usually I just had to introduce them and say, well, let's go to questions and answers, and they were wonderful. They knew the stuff, and I'm not an expert, nor am I an expert on Cornell, but nobody else really, as Paul said, has really written about Thomas Cornell, an amazing individual. This is, I'm really glad to be at this museum because I'm seeing Vanderlyn. I've done a bit of research on the Hudson River artists and also on Frederick Church, and Vanderlyn, of course, pops up at the very beginning of what this is all about. And to see this finally. Coming to Kingston so many times in the couple of years it took to write this Thomas Cornell book, I never came here inside. I've been past this building, but this is pretty amazing. It's also great that Santa Claus is here. You don't have your hat on anymore. Because my son Aaron and I are working on a book on Santa Claus. Do you have an email address?
I'm available for you.
That's great. Aaron, get his card, will you please? So I'm in luck in lots of ways. It's a beautiful place. As I said, I'm not an expert in the subject, but there's a lot of material here. And Paul put me to work because, as I said, I haven't given a talk in this book in about 10 years. And when at the time, it really was nice just to watch any of these gentlemen do their stuff. And it was very interesting to see to read the book again for the first time in all this time, which means this lecture is going to be about 3 hours. I hope you don't mind. I'm going to read a little bit from it, so my son is going to alert me when we get to the first half hour, and then we'll show some pictures from the book. There's only a couple of color ones, so don't expect them all to be spectacular. What we've got is original pictures of the boats, for the most part, and of some people, and of Rondout, too. Aaron and I and his wife, Amy, they live over in Red Hook, and we did a very nice video for the museum using the original art from the book. We had a friend do the music, and another friend did the narrative. And the narrative, I wrote the narrative, and a friend read it. Steve Roberts, who was pretty much a local guy. And he worked at MSNBC with Aaron's wife, Amy, and she did the putting all of it together. And so I sat down to listen, to see this little 12-minute piece, which of course took a lot of work, this video. And Steve is not saying Rondout, he's saying Roundout. And I said, Steve, it's Rondout. I've since learned that I just listened to Paul, he said Roundout. And so I said, what can we do? He said, all right, I'll just do it over again and we'll just change Roundout to Rondout. If I had known better, I would have left it the way it was. So, and I'd hoped to actually have this here tonight, but we've apparently lost the VHS and a couple of moves. We have it somewhere, but not handy. And you can hear everything's going along to suddenly hear him say, Roundout, you know, in the middle he's talking about it, Roundout, you know, like that. But it was a very nice piece. So I learned this after everything else. So being on the, going down to Rondout or Roundout, all the, you know, for the meetings of the Maritime Museum, which I had the privilege to be a member of, kind of another very helpful one, but at least for a couple of years. Bill Barry and Roger were the people that really, were three of the people who got that museum started. And that's how they got me on the board too. So I'll read a little bit from the book and I'll try to do a narrative to give you an idea of what really this is all about. Cornell and the Cornell Steamboat Company, which lasted, I think it was 137 years, if I'm not mistaken, from the time he started. If anyone has any questions as we go, please feel free, just raise your hand and we can just ask them. The Cornell vessels were among the most famous passenger steamboats in the history, not just passenger steamboats, there were all kinds of boats, but in the history of the Hudson. There were towboats and steamboats and passenger boats. Mary Powell, of course, being the most famous. Manhattan is another one. North America, Rip Van Winkle, Santa Claus, named in your honor. And the city of Kingston, and of course, Thomas Cornell. Others were named after prominent local people or their family members. Mary Powell, obviously, and Santa, obviously. Other regional names famous in the past that some of you people will obviously know. There are many Cornells. Cornelius Vanderbilt was the name of one of the tugboats. These boats might have been built by other companies and acquired by Cornell. So they didn't necessarily build a boat and then call it Cornelius Vanderbilt. George A. Hoyt, Maurice Wirtz, A.C. Cheney, Alicia A. Washburn, George W. Washburn, Ellen M. Ronan, Dr. David Kennedy. He was a prominent He was a prominent Roundout doctor who bottled an elixir known as Dr. Kennedy's favorite remedy. I think he was a friend of Cornell's, so that might have been in his honor in the remedies that one of the boats was named after him. Names such as Decker, Meade, Terry, Laverne, Caswell, Pratt, North, Schoonmaker or Schoenmaker, however you, that's a Dutch pronunciation and an American one, Quartz, Southwick, Hans, Fowler, Dixon, many Cornell clients, brick makers, and bluestone producers and ice house owners. And of course, that's the cargo they carried. So there were the clients. And also there was one called John Marshall, also acquired. This is a Supreme Court Chief Justice who heard the 1925 case that removed the steamboat monopoly that New York State had given Livingston and Fulton on the Hudson River. So for them having developed the first steamboat, they got the monopoly on steamboats. Well, Marshall took that away, or the Supreme Court removed that in the 1820s, excuse me. There's something called, I have a hard time with this word. I'm just gonna say it, Rondout in the 50s, page 33. Imagine writing this whole book and now I'm stumbling over the pronunciation of Rondout. Roundout. Let's see, it's page 33. There's not a whole lot of literature that's available unless you go to newspapers and so on. But there's a lot of folk work and things that people, that the museum had perhaps, and I found it somewhere. I don't know where I found this one, but in 1854, resident John Horton wrote his vivid Rondout in the 50s, published in one of the several local newspapers. Rondout on the pretty Rondout Creek will be a city very quick. I'm sure you don't say Rondout Creek. It has one bank and lots of stores besides the hardware store of Moore's. Lots of steamboats have we here that bring up freight and take down beer. They bring up merchants' eggs for pass, that means Easter for the Dutch. The North America and Santa Claus. He missed that one. At Cornell's dock, the Santa's moored for freight and passage apply on board. At Romer's and Gillette's down below, the North America colors blow. The mansion house is going up. I think that would have been Cornell's mansion house. For freight and passage, the mansion house is going up, and there the lager beer will sup. I guess it was a hotel. We go to Metzger's on the hill. We get our boots at William Still. Winter, he keeps a fancy store. Elting and Decker are next door. Canfield and Rosa across the street. And between them, Dusen's drugstore neat. And this goes on. There's Saddam's in this and all kinds of names. So the people that know this must find it very interesting. And there's a lot of this stuff. And I did a local history of a town I lived in New Jersey, my first local history, Lake of Patcong, the town of Patcong. And I met a lady, and she must have been in her 80s, a beautiful woman called Alice Stone. And she had the most wonderful, better than this, although this really moves you because it's your own people, most wonderful poetry. The one that we ended the book was The Old Back House. So you can imagine that was. If I remember, something like she said, and we treasure this, her brother smoking in the old back house and going out in the cold nights, and it was something along the lines of, and to this old back house, which took so much in life and gave back to us, and it was. So this is giving you an idea of the dynamic of Rondout in the 1850s. I came to this, as I said, I was asked by Ray Rominger of Purple Mountain Press and Fleischmann's, who's done a lot of local history. I'm concerned about suddenly if this thing starts to go, I'll just talk about it. I'm working right on the computer here, so I don't know what buttons I'm going to push by accident. Ray said, would I like to do this book? I said, well, I know a little bit about history and know nothing about boating, steamboats. And he brought me to Bill Spangenberger, in his 90s at that time, the last president of the Cornell Steamboat Company, a local Kingston man. Roger Mabee, as I said, from Port Ewan. I'll give you a little bit about their backgrounds after this, but and Barry Thomas, and they said, okay, he can do it. If you want to know what Bill looked like toward the end of his life, just imagine Washington up there without his wig when you go out, and you look at that, and Bill's hair wasn't as long, but it amazed me one day. I joked with that about him, and he said, yeah, I guess I do. Those who know Bill will understand him. So these are men, these three men, Spangenberger, Thomas, and Mabee, were men whose lives were closely connected with Hudson River boats and boatmen, professionally and with a direct link in their own families to the Cornell Steamboat Company or other steamboat operations in the mid-Hudson Valley. Bill was a Kingston native employed by Cornell. Bill passed away in 2008 at 102, I think I said that. He worked for the company from 1963. His father was the company barber, or the executive barber. Bill had an NYU degree. He joined Cornell and worked his way up to be assistant to the company president, Frederick Kirkendall, the son of the successor to Cornell, Cornell's grandson, and later became president, the last president of one of the country's great maritime companies. Bill closed his career soon after overseeing the building of the first push towboat to operate on the Hudson River, to Rockland County. Bill was not a boatman, but he was an excellent manager who saw Cornell through some difficult years in the transition from steam to oil. This is in the 1930s and 40s. And into the era of competition with trucks, the deepening of the Hudson River so ocean-going vessels could come upriver, spelling the end for most of the tugboats. Roger Mabee of Port Ewan, grandson of a Hudson River pilot and captain, and who as a young man, excuse me, worked on steamers of the Hudson River Day Line in his summers. He commanded a sub-chaser in the Pacific in World War II. Former supervisor of the town of Esopus, he's an MBA from Harvard Business School. He's on the board of trustees of Ulster Community College, past president of the Steamship Historical Society of America. These are all abbreviated, as you can imagine. These guys are amazing. William DuBarry Thomas, or Barry Thomas, naval architect and maritime historian with a lifelong interest in Thomas Cornell and the Cornell Steamboat Company. Great-grandfather was Thomas Marvel, builder of 13 tugs owned by Cornell, past president of the Steamship Historical Society of America. He gets the least because he's third there. But you can imagine what all of them, what their bios were like in regard. And anyone in this room who knows them knows more than I do, probably, what kind of people they are. They told me about the cargoes towed by Cornell, the bluestone, the Rosendale cement, bricks from all along the river, and fruits and vegetables from the valley's farms. Ice in the summer, cut and stored cut in the winter and stored for the following summer. And going back up, and the boats going back up river in the 1800s, they're mostly empty. The barges were empty. They were towed up, but some of them were full of horse manure from that emporium of manure. It's not funny, but I had to say it. New York City. Horse manure was essential. Really? I would have delivered it a little bit more casually. It was better when I wrote it. When I read it, I say, I don't know if you should say that. Anyway, I don't really mean that. Three of my grandchildren were born in New York City. Horse manure was essential to the mushroom business that was prominent in the Hudson Valley. And Cornell towed it upriver. And you knew it when it was passing, I think. These three men, their experience, knowledge, passion for maritime history, their lifelong connection to the Mid-Hudson region, and their remarkable passion for telling the story, they were a crucial part of the fabric of this region's maritime legacy. Not just the museum, but this book and their whole lives and all the things they did. For me as a writer, they were a kind of a perfect storm, the best source any history writer could ask for. And although I didn't think about it until I was preparing this talk, they personally were part of the legacy of Cornell's legacy and this region's steamboating legacy, a living embodiment. You know, I just was working with them, and the more I knew, you know, the more I had to reflect on it, and really now 10 years later, I really understood that even more, that they were that legacy, and the museum, of course, that they helped to create. Like so many families hark back to their own histories in the steamboating story here, many of them part of the Cornell Steamboat Company, Bill, Roger, and Barry could tell about their own relatives in that world. And they could also articulate with historical fact and a passion for the history and the story of every boat. That's what Cornell and the Hudson River boating industry, they could tell you, was all about. And this book and whatever I know really came from them. I just had to not get in the way when I was working with them. To build up to this narrative and the story of Cornell and to these photographs, these film slides tonight or whatever they are, I guess they're on a CD. This is not really a build-up, because there are many people just like them in this region, many of them connected with the museum. But when I undertook to write this book, I was really outnumbered by the three of them, and they took it easy on me and they guided me along. It was really, really a great experience. You often, when you do local history, the people who know the history or know the art or have control over the artifacts, they want to hold it because they want to write the book. And sometimes you find yourself unable to do a book or feeling very disappointed. I did a book on Rudyard Kipling some years ago in Brattleboro, and one of the key people who had the information and everything, so much of it, he said, it's not organized yet, you can't read it yet. I found lots of other information, and generally you always have too much. Wrote the book. Associated Press wanted to do a story on the book and on myself, on me, and asked me to go to the library I'd done all this research at. And it was not the librarian who kept the stuff from me. She was a great help. And when I got there, this is a year after the book came out, all these new things were beautifully bound in red. Beautifully bound in red. I said, where did these come from? Oh, that's from the guy who has been organizing this all the time. But there was so much stuff, it was actually a mercy, that if I'd had that, the book still would never have been written. And this could have been the same, of course, with this. What I've done tonight is just taking part of this book and talking about Cornell. So those three people, for whatever else they've done, I'm very grateful for what they've done for me. My own maritime career is being seasick 5 out of 10 days at sea when my family came over from Scotland in 1956. My father was sick too, and he was in the Navy, so it wasn't so bad. It was a rough crossing. And I spent half a year as a very lowly deckhand on a Swedish merchant ship when I was 24. But that's enough in some ways. That gives you a sense of feeling for being interested in and respecting what these people did as boatsmen. Barry wrote some beautiful essays, Barry Thomas, a very fine writer, for this book. One is called The Art of Towing, another technology along the Rondout, another storming the barge canal, none of which I'm going to talk about tonight. And he also wrote a fleet list of 180 vessels, paragraph in every boat, almost every boat that was known to belong to Cornell. And at the very end, he had about half a dozen boats that he called spurious vessels, ones that might have been Cornell, but we weren't sure. I'd like to read you an example of one of these. There's a boat that Cornell built, you may know about, called the City of Kingston. Magnificent, propeller-driven, not a paddle boat, still steam. I won't read all of this because there's quite a bit of material here, but the City of Kingston, and it had electricity, which is quite unusual, 300 lights. First he describes the dimension and the length and the iron hull, and it had a compound engine, the bore of the engine, 1,400 horsepower, very powerful, built in 1884. I'm just paraphrasing this. All this stuff is in here. Built by Harlan and Hollingworth Company, Wilmington, Delaware, for Cornell Steamboat Company, for service between Rondout and New York, launched 11 March. First trip was from New York to Rondout on 31st May, 1889, was sold to Puget Sound, an Alaska steamship company, fitted for voyage to West Coast at T.S. Marvel and Company, Newburgh, New York. That's his grandfather's company, great-grandfather's company, Barry Thomas's. 1889, 18th of November, sailed from New York, 1890, early January, passed through the Strait of Magellan. That's a type of South America, of course. On 17 February, arrived at Port Townsend, Washington, ran between Tacoma, Washington, and Bellingham, Washington, making intermediate landings, later between Tacoma and Victoria, B.C. 1899, 23rd April, sank your city of Kingston after a collision at 0430 hours with British steamship Glen Ogle off Browns Point near Tacoma while inbound to that port. Every single thing is a story here, every little phrase, every little description. If this boat had been renamed, he would have explained that. If it had been refitted or converted or changed, he tells that story, a fleet list, a magnificent thing. Of course, the hard part was getting him to say it's ready to publish. So you can imagine I was outnumbered and very grateful for what they gave me. Roger, maybe we'll read some of the captions to these that they wrote. Roger wrote about a side-wheel towboat Syracuse of 1857, which is not seen tonight. This classic image of the side-wheel towboat Syracuse of 1857 evokes nothing short of admiration for the mid-19th century shipbuilder and marine engineer. Working with wood and cast iron and employing little in the way of mechanical aids to construction, they were able to produce artifacts which combined in perfect proportion the best of art and engineering. Nearly 50 years later, one can only marvel at the perfection that was Syracuse, the sixth and next to last large sidewheeler built expressly for towing. So you can imagine when the talk was given on this, I just sat back and listened, and everyone else did too. You see what they had. Bill was not a boatman. He didn't know a lot about the boats, but he knew the business, and he was the one who worked between the executives. There were two brothers, two Kirkendall brothers in the 20th century. Frederick, who was also president of Columbia University, Frederick and Edward, who was up here, and you see Kirkendall honored at Ulster Community College and so on. That was generally Edward. And he ran the railroad side of things much more to his, he preferred to run the railroads than the steamboats. So a lot of steamboat problems arose, and Bill was constantly going between the two brothers. But this gives you an example of what I read, what these men, how they cared about this subject. I'd written the whole book over and researched it, probably about 2 years, I think. And Bill said, the history looks good. I agree with everything you said. And I sent the manuscript, of course, to Barry and Roger. And So, okay, let's get together. We went over to Roger's house in Port Ewen, which looked across the river. Big picture windows, very beautiful. You saw everything that, that came up. And they sat down with Barry and Roger. They had their manuscripts on their knees. I had my manuscript, you know, thinking this is going to be an hour. And they said, well, the history is good. It's okay. You know, it works. It's correct. No real objections to that. And we're happy with what you did. Now let's get to work. That was what Barry said. And I was used to working with people that they loved the stuff, you know, but often it was very egotistical, and they wanted it their way, and they wanted it because they wanted it their way. That's how they believed in it. It was nothing like that at all, although it was a work session. And they were correcting descriptions of boats, or they were adding to boats, or they were telling me it was a diesel instead of a steamer, or that it was converted to steam 10 years later, which wasn't just a fleet list piece of information. It was actually important for some reason. And so we did this work, and it was work. And my manuscript, I would be sitting there in the living room, and I see their manuscript on their knee, and there's some writing on each one, and I patiently looked at that page, and then we would talk about that, and they'd put the page, they go to the next page, and it'd be blank, and I'd start to turn the page, and Barry would be going like this. Oh, yeah. And there'd be something else coming up. And it was a great experience, and one of the best experiences I've ever had writing history, just doing it with them. As for Cornell, you got the idea basically from the foreword that Paul read. The D&H Canal is really what started it all. Let me just read a little bit of that to give you a sense of it. A chapter called Canals, Coal, and Steam. And I'm sure you all know that a lot of money was put into canals when the Erie Canal was such a big success. And railroads came in very quickly and displaced them. And all that money was lost. And new money was spent and lost also on the railroads. But the D&H Canal that came from the Delaware River to the Hudson was successful because it was bringing down coal. And the canal boats were perfect for that. They started at 30 tons. And within 10 or 12 years, the canal was deepened, and they were bringing down 136 tons in each boat. And those boats were capable of going down river on a tow, in some cases, you know, 90 of them at a time, being towed by a steamboat. Just to briefly give you an idea how I wrote about it. It was coal that started it all. Pennsylvania anthracite mined near the upper Delaware River and shipped by canal boats 108 miles along the narrow Delaware and Hudson Canal to tidewater at Eddyville, 3 miles upstream from the mouth of Rondout Creek. From there, it went by the Hudson River to the growing cities north, south, and east. Coal made the first fortune of young Thomas Cornell, founder of the Cornell Steamboat Company. Coal and the appetites of the canal workers, who in 1828 built the D&H. Their every need had to be shipped in by water and bought in general stores at the docks near the canal's first lock and the canal basin. And the Cornell family, Cornell was originally from White Plains, a Connecticut family that moved over the generations. And they were very much in the freighting business, and also in emporiums that were at the end of this end of the canal. So, you know, you can probably make more money feeding the workers than you can actually investing in the canal. But in his case, he was there at the right time. One comparison with Vanderbilt, and I had to, when I saw the title of this essay about 4 days ago, and what was the title again? Thomas Cornell and the Vanderbilt of the Rondout. And I said, well, I don't know much about Vanderbilt. I can't really make the comparisons. And I said, well, I can slide over that. But of course, you're right, they were both giants in their own areas. Cornell was never as big as Vanderbilt, but he was as big as he could be in a very important region. One thing they did start the same way as boatmen. Vanderbilt, as a young man in the War of 1812, which wasn't that long before this all happened, 1815, in that whole time period, there was the fighting. He made his first fortune, or he made his first living, by running sloops in New York Harbor to the various forts here and there, always at risk of a British warship slipping in and capturing him, which could have been done, because we didn't control the seas, obviously. And the same with Cornell. He wasn't as dramatic, but he had a sloop, and that's how he started out. So he knew the business from the bottom up. He ran his own sloop very effectively. very quickly, the steamboating industry, as I said, after Fulton and Livingston right here built their own steamboat, and then they had to give up their monopoly, it took off, it exploded. It actually exploded literally, unfortunately, but beyond that, it was very successful. Passenger steamers developed and competed fiercely. Boats raced with each other. They sideswiped each other to get into dock first. There were a number of accidents and sinkings, and some with hundreds of casualties. I'm sure many of you know these stories. At first, they were in such a hurry to beat each other that many boats in the beginning let off and picked up passengers by a small boat that was tethered to the steamer by a rope. So the boat is either going with or fighting the current. There's a small boat on a being rowed in to shore on a line. They get to the wharf. There's a bunch of people waiting on the wharf to get into this boat before it's too late. There's a bunch of people on the boat trying to get off onto the dock. There's baggage being thrown down and tossed up at the same time. It was very dangerous. It wasn't allowed to continue. They was outlawed, and also as was racing. After a lot of people were killed, of course. In 1849, Thomas W. Cornell, I'm addressing his grandfather as his uncle, I should say, and he were in a partnership at the beginning, and then the uncle withdrew, Thomas W. Cornell. But they, for a long time, they had a very important part of the steamboating industry between Rondout and New York City. The Cornell family, and also Anderson, Romer and Company is a big, famous name. And of course, they were in strict competition, and Little Rondout was the busiest port between New York and Albany. In 1851, the uncle withdrew from the company, and Thomas C. Cornell assumed control. He owned several what they called Bells of the Waterfront, B-E-L-L-E-S, and these were not the big steamers; these were the towing steamers. The Norwich, the Mohegan, and James Madison. They were still considered very grand vessels, and you'll see that in these pictures. He also managed the ferry line from Rondout to Rhinebeck. He was in and out of the passenger steamboat business, buying and selling and refurbishing boats, some he was building. He had a fleet of 20 canal boats operating in the D&H Canal. He became a director of the canal company. He and his wife, the former Catherine Ann Woodman Say, had four children, two girls and two boys, but the boys died in infancy, which opened the door for S.T. Kirkendall, Kirkendall was a family name from this area, but in his case, he lived down near Port Jervis. People migrated from this area that way in the 1800s. And so Kirkendall became his heir after marrying Cornell's daughter. So his own two sons had died in infancy. Thomas Cornell was an honorary major in the local militia. At the outbreak of the Civil War in 1861, his steamer Manhattan and a barge in tow carried the 20th New York Militia to New York City, and from there they took a railroad to Washington, D.C. to be one of the first regiments, volunteer militias, to help defend the city. One thing, as Barry Thomas told me, is you don't say the Manhattan. You don't say, you don't use the, you say Manhattan. You don't say the Titanic. You say Titanic, and I forget that, but if you know your business, I guess that's one of the things you understand. I've tried to carry that through in the book. That was 10 years ago, and I'll still say the wrong way, but Manhattan carried troops several times during the war, the Civil War. The vessel's 25-year-old clerk resigned his job on that vessel, working for Cornell, and he enlisted as a first lieutenant and a regimental quartermaster of the 156th New York Volunteers, no longer militia. These were volunteer regiments in for 3 years, not 6 months. This was Samuel Decker Kirkendall. He was a future son-in-law. And in 1862, Thomas Cornell unsuccessfully ran for Congress. 65, S.D. Kirkendall married his daughter, Mary Augusta. In 1866, Thomas Cornell began his railroading enterprises, chartering the Rondout Oswego Railroad, organizing the Rhinebeck and Connecticut Railroad, and the Delhi Middletown Railroad. He believed tourism and sleeper cars would make the railroads the passenger carriers of the future, and he sold some of his passenger steamers. The Rondout and Oswego Railroad failed very quickly, but it was reorganized as the Ulster and Delaware Railroad. And the way a lot of these railroads were financed, and we're not going to get into that, was a town up the line where you were going to build would raise some money. And they were talking about raising money all the way from Rondout to Oswego. So when the company failed, it was no longer Rondout and Oswego. There were a lot of people who had invested in this. There were a lot of court cases, a lot of litigation. I would think, I mean, that's something that Cornell was constantly busy with, whether it was the boats or the railroads, litigation of all kinds. It's a little different to call yourself the, the Ulster and Delaware, and to call yourself the Rondout and Oswego. It's a whole different idea of financing that thing. Anyway, despite that, he was elected to the 40th Congress in 67 and 69, and he failed to be reelected, which may have had something to do with the failure of these railroads that so many people were unhappy about. Rondout, if you don't mind my saying it that way, in 1868, there's a nice description. The Mid-Hudson region was roaring in 1868, with brickyards along the west shore from Haverstraw Bay north to Coxsackie. In a couple of decades, there would be approximately 140 of them, annually providing millions of common brick to builders in the New York City region. Combined with the traditional Mid-Hudson Valley industries of leather tanning, lumber, farm produce, and quarrying, a vital ice-cutting industry approaching maturity, as did boat building, especially of canal boats. The D&H Canal had as many as 1,000 working canal boats using the channel each year, with 3 million tons of coal shipped in 1 year. And there's bluestone, and we can just keep on going with this. This is the region that produced the cement. Half an hour, ready for this? Okay. That's all you need to know. Now, I did a quick breakdown of Cornell's years. The city of Kingston was built in established in 1872. And the year before, Cornell had founded the Rondout Daily Freeman, which, excuse me, very quickly became the Rondout, the Kingston Daily Freeman. Pretty old newspaper. So Rondout was very unhappy about this because they were twice as big in population as Kingston. But Kingston had a political pull, apparently that Cornell did not have. And the town became called Kingston, the city of Kingston. So the various railroads were going and coming, and he was losing money and gaining money. Steamboating was still thriving. Cornell owned the Rosendale Cement, and that's the consolidated Rosendale Cement, which provided the cement for the Brooklyn Bridge. Whole story by itself. It hardened underwater, was very, very hard, but ultimately couldn't compete with the cement from Maine, the more common cement, because it was good enough, basically. Thank goodness the Brooklyn Bridge is made of Rosendale cement. He served again in Congress in the early 1880s. He sold his railroads, organized new railroads, and his beautiful steamer that you'll see on here, called the Thomas Cornell, after him, was lost off Danskammer Point in 1882. Danskammer is a Dutch term, and it was tied in with the full name, the Devil's Danskammer, the Devil's dance hall, dancing chamber, because it was so dangerous there, like Spout and Duyvel, which actually you would say Spite and Duyvel, Spite and Duyvel, which means to spite the devil, not because of swirling, it's you're going to dare and you're going to go through that area. So Danskammer was originally the Duyvel's Danskammer. Anyway, the railroads were a big thing, and by 1884 there were 60 steamers and 400 employees in the Cornell Steamboat Company. And in 1890, he sold the passenger and freight traffic to Romer and Company, and he just went on with the towing business. And that year, in March, on March 30th, he died. Thomas Cornell died of pneumonia at the age of 77. The departure of the city of Kingston, which had left at that time, ended the passenger steamer business for Thomas Cornell, who also sold the franchise outright to Romer and Tremper. And then early in 1890, he fell ill, contracted pneumonia, and died at home on March 30th, age of 77. Rondout and Kingston's most prominent citizen, Ulster County's most powerful figure, and one of the leading businessmen in the United States, Thomas Cornell was deeply mourned by family, friends, and employees. The companies he founded and led with brilliance, courage, and foresight would continue, and for some decades would be as strong as ever. He had an able successor and son-in-law, Samuel D. Kirkendall, however, and surely some of his six grandsons would rise to the management of the far-flung family business empire Thomas Cornell had built, that Cornell had built from one modest sloop. Whatever lay in the future, Cornell would be missed for a long time to come by the people of the Mid-Hudson Valley. On the day of his funeral, it was a testimony to the community's affection for him that gleaming locomotives slowly pulled handsome coaches draped with black crepe through town, and carriages decorated with flowers in the form of a steamboat and a locomotive followed the funeral procession. For this day, all business along the industrious Rondout Creek came to a complete stop. That's who we don't know very much about. I will do my best to maneuver these photographs taken from the book, and you can see some of the things we've been talking about. I'll be reading the captions as they come. I'll try to anyway. I guess. Hang on, please. This is the Pocahontas. And you see a steamboat, a tugboat with the classic two stacks. Later would have one stack. I wish Barry was here right now. But I think you'll get the idea. The Cornell Steamboat Company, by the way, went on to 1958, and Bill Spangenberger became the president. Against the odds, trucks, ocean-going vessels carrying freight, not enough diesel. They didn't get into the oil business early enough, and so on and so forth. And it was bought by their main client, probably their only client, New York Trap Rock, down in Nyack. And for New York Trap Rock, you'll see it here, Bill helped to design the first push towboat on the Hudson River. And in 1964, Lone Star Industries and Martin Marietta bought Trap Rock and discontinued the Cornell Steamboat Company completely, which at that point was a wholly owned subsidiary. This is the front cover of the book. The real painting was done with Pocahontas in reverse, but publisher couldn't stand that, but decided, yes, Ray, it says in the caption, this has been reversed. Beautiful looking vessel. This is a Rob painting picture done by Len Tantillo, happens to be the brother of Joe. Joe's the person who set this up. Len is one of the finest maritime painters in the country today, and in the world perhaps, and also one of the best painters of early colonial times and early New York. A lot of knowledge there. This is apparently Breakneck Hill. Bill Spangenberger owned both these pictures. He bought this from Len, commissioned it. Here's the push towboat with all that rock on the Hudson. You can see it's not pulling, it's pushing, it's got a snub nose. Barry Thomas said he admired how powerful it was, 1,400 horsepower and so on and so forth. He said, but not very elegant. As a naval architect, he knew what he was saying. This is the older picture there on the left, obviously, of Cornell. This is him probably around 1850, 1860. He looks like a member of Congress here with the requisite crazy beard. Sorry, it's coming back. I know I shouldn't say that. This is the Norwich. This is one of their first boats. Very powerful towboat. This was acquired in 1848. I'll read a few of these captions to give you an idea. These are written by Roger Mabee. The towboat Norwich, built for passenger and freight service on Long Island Sound, came to the Hudson River in the 1840s and was later purchased by Thomas Cornell, who converted her to a towboat in 1851. During the Hudson Fulton celebration of 1909, Norwich played an important role. And on her paddle wheel housing was painted, quote, the oldest steamboat in the world, built in 1836. It's a picture from his collection. This is the Manhattan. I said it wrong. This is Manhattan. A lot of these paintings were done by the Bards, as many of you know. A famous couple of brothers who painted these usually for the owners, and they're almost more like an architectural illustration. I don't know how well you can see it from there, but it's the Pittston. Very strong, tough little boat, much smaller than the other ones. And that's Barry Thomas' caption. The side-wheel towboat Pittston, built in 1850, shown at South Rondout near the end of her career, was used almost exclusively for towing canal boats and coal barges in and around Rondout Creek, first for the Pennsylvania Coal Company and then for Cornell from 1868 until dismantled in 1909. Again, you don't need to know this, of course. I don't need to know this, but it's just fascinating to hear how the real expert would write about this. Samuel Decker Kirkendall, probably around the time he was a clerk on Manhattan before he married Cornell's daughter. The famous Mary Powell, said to be the queen of the Hudson and the fastest boat on the river. Cornell owned her twice, bought and sold her twice. Queen of the Hudson launched in 1861, built for Absalom Anderson of Rondout, the real competition of Anderson of Cornell. And now these boats are, as I said, mostly running from Rondout to New York. Very seldom went up to Albany. And the tugs, the tugboats, they very seldom worked anywhere except on the river, sometimes in New York City. This boat was named for Mary Ludlow Powell, widow of Thomas Powell, Newburgh businessman, after whom the steamer Thomas Powell was named. Thomas Powell, the original, this first steamer, Thomas Powell, set a record from New York City to Rondout, 4 hours and 39 minutes. That boat was a competitor with Cornell, as Mary Powell would become. Mary Powell was not as fast as Anderson had hoped she would be when it was built. And as I said, Thomas Cornell bought her twice, 1865, in a partnership with Daniel Drew, talk about one of the robber barons. And he had the boat till 1869. And then he bought her again in 1862 and sold her again in 1884 after the new city of Kingston was launched. She was dismantled in Rondout Creek in 1920. And I've seen pictures, the sad pictures of the remains of this beautiful boat. And as you can imagine, Roger maybe had some parts of this boat. The Mary Powell was built to outdo the Thomas Cornell, which sank on Dance Camera Point, which was built to outdo Mary Powell, because Cornell built his boat. Let's take the next one. Here she is. This is the Thomas. This is Thomas Cornell. She was built to outdo Mary Powell. At 286 feet, she was 10 feet longer. But before she was finished, Absalom Anderson cut Mary Powell in half before Thomas Cornell was finished, and he added another 21 feet. So he was bigger and faster. Described as the perfect hull for the perfect engine. That sounds like Roger Mabey's talk. Which also made her faster and the fastest on the Hudson. So he finally got this. What he had said to the builder, if you don't make it at a certain speed, I'm not going to pay the hull. And she didn't get as fast as she was supposed to be. But by now, when Cornell had something faster, Anderson went to the extreme of... she then beat the record of her... of the husband's boat, Thomas Powell, by 9 minutes up and down the river. This is the Thomas Cornell steamer, typical work boat, you can see. I think this is, but if it's not, it's a typical boat. Yeah, I think this is one of those anyway. You see the crew. Of course, Barry and Roger will tell you who they are just by where they're standing on the deck. You know, There's the fireman, there's the cook, there's the captain, which I can't do. You know, let me see what boat, it's going to take me a while to find it. That's Rondell, yes. Yes. That's what I meant, Rondell. Whistles and signals. You might not see this too well, but you see short and long signals from the boats. You have to know these things. The last one says, 6 long blasts. Distress signal. Any steamer without a tow, upon hearing this signal, must reply at once. and render assistance without fail. This signal to be given only when in distress. But the crewmen had to learn these signals. There's a signal for hooking up the tow, for releasing the tow, and so on and so forth. The hawsers, the hero hawsers there. And there's just a little vignette here. There was a young boatman always had to have had news stories to exchange with their families. One told in later years was about an eager young and green deckhand, who well knew that the Cornell signal of one long and two short blasts meant the tugboat wanted his hawsers cast off, you know, the steel cables, so with a tow behind, meaning releasing the tow. What the deckhand apparently did not know was that the one long and two short was also the nautical rules of the road that meant a tug with a tow was underway in a fog. So one night as the fog set in off Hyde Park, a Cornell tug was alone with an up tow, the helper having already gone on ahead to Kingston, helper tugboat. So the tug captain was by himself in his boat. He blew the rules of the road signal as required in a fog while he drew near Kingston and Rondout Creek. After a while, he realized his vessel was moving ahead very fast, unusually fast. At that moment, the young deckhand entered the pilot house and cheerfully said, "All right, Cap, all gone." The captain said, "What do you mean by that?" "I threw the hawsers off. You blew, didn't you?" It was the captain who blew just then. The tow was drifting free somewhere out in the night fog. He might have had 50 or 60 barges out there. He had to turn around immediately and find it before another boat collided with it or it went aground somewhere downriver. Not only did they have to find the tow, but they had to recover the hawsers, which had drifted under the tow after being cast off. Of course, they were coming upriver, and the river sent everything back down. And they did it. Similar remarkable boatsmanship was needed every day by Cornell men. So in the fog, they had to find the tow and get the cables back. These guys were so good, they knew where they were in the river. They could sound the horn, and they'd calculate by how quickly the echo came back where they were, or how close they were to shore. This next one is the A.B. Valentine. This was a wonderful and powerful towboat. It was built from Santa Claus, the original Santa Claus. So these boats, the hulls and so on, would be used again. Rondout Creek panorama. Haven't seen this for a long time. It's a little like Dysfunction Junction at rush hour. I was told that's what you called that. You know what I'm talking about, I think, right? That's what Tripp told me, actually, Tripp Inglesby. You don't know what Dysfunction Junction is? All right, then. I won't say it. Good. This is Rondout Creek. If you think a little bit, you'll know what Dysfunction Junction is with your highways, the circle, and all that stuff out there. It wasn't my idea. I only want to insult one city in New York once. I insulted New York City already. You can see all those canal boats, storage ready to go, or all kinds of boats. You can see I'll just read this one too. Well, it doesn't matter. There's too many to read. But this is Rondout Creek in a way it doesn't look anymore. Pretty spectacular. I would imagine that these things in front of us are probably Cornell works. This is the J.C. Hart, another beautiful boat. You see the front, if you can see it, is all bent and crushed, the nose in the very front. They had accidents. In this case, I'll read what happened to it. The venerable iron-hulled, J.C. Hart at T.S. Marvel and Company Shipyard in Newburgh to repair a bruised stem resulting from a collision with the old colony line's City of Brockton on September 28, 1887, while on their way to yacht races off Sandy Hook, Barry Thomas. And again, Marvel was his great-grandfather's shop. Is S.D. Kirkendall, now thoroughly the second president of Cornell Steamboat Company. Pretty amazing man, they say. He was coming up on the train when he got the news. No, he may have gotten the news before that. He was coming up on the train and he went past the wreck of the Thomas Cornell, the beautiful steamship. And people said they saw him reading his paper. He never turned a hair, he never flinched. He came off the boat, he came off the train here in Rhinebeck. Newspaper man went up to him and said, Mr. Kirkendall, do you hear what happened? He said, I have some things to do at the office. I'll talk to you later. He never showed the slightest emotion of losing the finest steamboat they owned, and maybe one of the finest on the Hudson River ever. These are Kirkendall's children. I want to read this caption so you know who they are. The one on the far left, I believe, is Frederick, who became the president of the company, and he also became the chairman of Columbia University. He's the one who gave the keys to the university to Dwight D. Eisenhower when he became the president of Columbia before he became president of the United States. So the six sons and one daughter of S.D. Kirkendall and Mary Augusta Cornell Kirkendall. Left to right at rear are Frederick, Edward, the brother who became the one who took over the everyday operations of the Cornell Steamboat Company and also was very active and preferred the railroads. Harry S. and Thomas C. Thomas C. on the right was the genius, a mechanical genius. He was the eldest. And you don't hear much about him, but he was busy doing all kinds of things with the tugs, with the steamboats, doing all kinds of improvements and development. In the front are Frank, Catherine, and Robert. They didn't all get completely involved with the business. This is 1893 wreckage. And this happened each spring the ice broke on the Rondout and the water came down fast. And in this case, these represent no fewer than 14 tugs and towboats that wound up in the mouth of Rondout Creek on the aftermath of what they call a freshet in 1893. So these all had to be brought back, repaired, and some of them sank sometime. There are pictures of them that actually went under. They didn't go under, but this is the Cornell, one of the more beautiful tugs in 1902, and that's the railroad bridge at Poughkeepsie that now you can walk over. Imagine if you could see these boats, that would really be a tourist attraction. Maybe someday. Here's the Rob, the one that was on the cover, the Len Tantillo did a beautiful painting of, on the ways. You can see some pretty beautiful lines, and some of the boats are much more sleek and much more yacht-like. So she's either being built or she's being repaired. I'm sure Barry Thomas will tell me. Yep, the newly built tug Rob is on John J. Basden's Marine Railway at Slatesburg. Is that how you pronounce that? Slatesburg or Slatesburg? Slates. And judging from the formal poses of the yard workers, this is Roger Mabey, from the formal poses of the yard workers and the fact that the tug's hull is newly coppered, it's obvious, the occasion was probably the launching of the vessel in 1902. Basin Shipyard was located at the vicinity of the present oil storage tanks at Slatesburg and opposite the Cornell shops. The slip of the Rhinebeck Ferry, located upstream of the shops, is visible just over Rob's stern. For a moment I was thinking to myself, I'm going too deep in this, and I realized this is a historical society here. We're in a museum, so you're the kind of people that this would be interesting to, and of course, the local angle also. The book does a better job than I do. Here we see Rondout Creek again. 124, I'll tell you when this was. The twilight of a towboat's career. The side wheeler, Oswego, is depicted in layup in the slip at the lower end of Island Dock, probably somewhere around 1918 or 1919. Moored along Oswego's starboard side are three unidentified Cornell tugboats. I bet that must have upset those guys. They didn't know what those boats were. And a canal boat. The railroad tracks in the foreground are the sidings of the Ulster and Delaware Railroad. I'm just kidding, because they were the kind of guys who could give me this information freely. And that means that they were true historians and not just obsessed with collecting this information. We've got a couple more. You'll see Frederick Kirkendall. He was a bibliophile. He gave his collection to a collection of books, his library, to Columbia and started and was very key to the operations of Columbia University Press, great publishing house. These are, here you can really see the beauty of these boats. This would be, yeah, right. This is just titled Tugs at Rondout Shops on my notes. But you can see those classic powerful lines of these boats. And they were close to the end of their days here. They were going to be either converted to diesel or they were going to be scrapped. Some of them had a resurgence during World War II, but mostly not. Three stalwart and powerful tugs, E.L. Levy, E.C. Baker, and J.C. Hart, who we saw earlier, are shown at the Rondout shops early in the 20th century. Hart was built for Cornell in 1883 and remained in the fleet until 1949, just after the war, although she was inactive for many of her final years. Levy and Baker were purchased from C.W. Morse's consolidated towing line in 1901 and sold in 1917, and so on and so forth. Well, we're getting close. This is one of the more beautiful images following. Again, if you like tugboats. This is the Osceola on the left and J.C. Adams at the mouth of Esopus Creek. And they have a tow behind them. For some reason, I thought they were about to turn and go up the creek, but they actually are heading somewhere. I don't know how they would get 40 or 50 or maybe 90 canal boats in there. Is anyone here could tell me how that was done? They probably, and very often, they would drop off the boats to the clients as they were coming up river, so that one tugboat would be pulling and the other boat would be taking the barges and the loaded barges to their clients, going up river, the empty barges. But it was still amazing seamanship. So it brings us back to the end of the Cornell Steamboat Company, and if you remember that first picture of the Rockland County, the first push towboat on the Hudson River. And I'm going to read to close with Barry Thomas's comments. I kind of can't resist it. On that boat, we have another picture of it, but you can still see what it looked like. I can't go back to it, but just imagine that square little thing with huge 1,400 horsepower. In that days, it was a lot. The push towboat Rockland County, the diesel propelled push towboat pioneered on the nation's western rivers by the Dravo Corporation, her builder, promised to revolutionize the movement of barges on the Hudson. Compare the appearance of this third generation towboat to those of her predecessors, meaning the ones we just were looking at, the steam tugboat, and before that, the sidewheeler. Whatever Rockland County may have lacked in aesthetic appeal, she more than made up for in efficiency and power. He could have said it backwards. No matter how powerful she was, she just wasn't. He said it the polite way. She lacked aesthetic appeal. But those are the boats we see on the river, and they're still very busy. And now, of course, a lot of things are going up by ocean-going ships that just come right up the river. I hope I didn't take too long, and I really thank you for being here. If there are questions, I probably can't answer them, but I'll do my best.
Does anybody have any questions for Stuart?
Did Cornell have any association with Cornell?
No. Question was whether Cornell and Cornell University had a relationship.
No. Where did Cornell cousin live in Kingston? Ezra. Ezra was his cousin.
Well, wrong again. Really? I looked it up.
Where did the family live in Kingston?
Some people can say Wirt
Street. How much Cornell had done? Wirt's Avenue. Wirt Street. When you're going down, there's Cornell Park, and just up the hill there's a stone wall. There's some machines doing some work now. The home is gone, but there still are the stairs.
I'm really glad to hear that. To know that, because I thought I'd done some research and it said there's no relationship. The Cornells came out of New England, and there was a long time period where New Englanders were prospering, 250,000 of them, and the Dutch here wouldn't let them come through, wouldn't let them get out. They weren't allowed because the two kings had agreed, you know. And so when they finally broke out, like the Cornells, they spread out very quickly, and I guess they went all the way to Ithaca. So Ezra Cornell, yes, sir?
My name is Tom Cornell, and my son's name is Tom Cornell. And if there's anybody here who knows something about the family, let's leave out here. My great-great-grandfather's Thomas Richard Cornell, far Rockaway, Long Island. So the Cornells came out of Rhode Island.
Rhode Island. Rhode Island, then Connecticut.
The south, across the sound into Long Island.
Did they start in Long Island?
Yeah.
A lot of... Well, Long Island belonged to... Yeah, well,
Cornell of Essex, born in 1595, arrived in what's now Rhode Island in 1637.
Did they actually, the Dutch let a lot of the New Englanders come and settle on Long Island. They actually couldn't stop them, actually. But you're saying Cornell later went to Long Island, but they didn't.
Cornell's got pushed out of Rhode Island by the Indians. They were settling. They were coming further down towards, they were trying to settle the lower part of Rhode Island. And that's where the Indians were, forced out And they made their way across the Sound.
And they went to Long Island.
They were granted a lot of land. They became very wealthy in land.
Well, when the English decided they were going to attack New Amsterdam,
right.
You know, the Long Islanders, most of them New Englanders, they massed at Brooklyn, or Brooklyn it was called then, as the Dutch name. And so there was a little fleet of six English warships, which really probably would have had a tough time capturing the city, because they didn't have that many troops. But the Long Islanders, probably Cornell too, they said, if you don't surrender, we're going to sack the town. And they meant it. That's another story. That's my book, Yankee Doodle book. Yankee Doodle was a Dutch name for the New Englanders, because they were English, and it meant John Fool. Yankee meaning Johnny Fool, that was a typical name. But there was a lot of very hard feelings between them, mainly because they were kissing cousins. The English who settled in New England had originally been Dutch and Flemish who had come over for religious freedom to Eastern England. And the people who came to, and when they came to New England, their language, their official language was Dutch, because a lot of those people had served in the Dutch military also. So there's a strong connection. But of course you had family feuds, and as I said, the Dutch didn't let the New Englanders go west. There were 18,000 people living here, 250,000 living there, including probably a few thousand Cornells, I think, no doubt. Any other questions?
I think actually Cornell started with a K. Actually.
Oh, really? You see Cornwell.
The Cornells are K'd, but if you go to Long Island, chances are a huge portion of people, they go far back on their deeds, a Cornell on their land.
They owned the land originally.
Yeah, they owned all of Flushing, and all of Greasy Point, and all the Rockaways.
Well, in those days, people like the Dutch call it Flissinga. I had a Dutch wife, so I know that stuff.
Have you talked about Montreux Cemetery?
Well, I talked about a lot of stuff, but that's, of course, where they're buried, the family's there.
Yeah.
Very spectacular, and also Bill Spangenberger. Who's?
Spangenberger's,
yeah.
But the site is beautiful, and it's in need of restoration.
Yeah, it's a spectacular place.
Get together people that want to restore it, because it's beautiful.
Well, did you bring your hat?
Well,
pass it around?
We are discussing doing that in the presentation on the Kirkland College will be in spring.
That's great.
Have any other questions?
It's a wonderful heritage, and I'm really glad to be here. Yes?
Any survivors of the Kirkendall?
I don't really know. Bill Spangenberger took over when Frederick didn't want to do it anymore, and he was sort of out of the business. This is the late 40s, early 50s. Does anyone know? Yes, sir?
None of those Kirkendalls had any children.
Not one of the...
Six boys and daughters.
I think, but there was a daughter... Named married a Bayard. She didn't have children either. She didn't have any children either.
No.
Yeah, well, that's why.
It's
yeah. It is amazing.
Two kids came to my shop. They were like 24, 25 years old. They're Quirkendall.
Quirkendall.
Yeah, there are some in the area.
They're looking for jobs, right? And they said SD was their great grandfather or something like that.
Well,
I don't know if there's any jobs.
direct descendant.
I know something about the Dutch culture here, and it's all mixed up.
The whole wealth is gone.
Really?
Amazing. The entire wealth is gone.
Yeah, well, they lost a They lost a lot. In the, of course, it's a big family, too. And Dutch would have called it Kalkendal, meaning Chickendale, Chicken Valley. So they must have been chicken farmers back in somewhere before Long Island.
Any other questions? Okay.
Thanks once again.
Stuart, thank you very, very much.
Thank you. And
everybody, I do, if you do get a chance, I highly recommend this book, The Thomas Cornell and the Cornell Steamboat Company. I read it because I have a soft spot for robber barons, and let's not disguise it. Thomas Cornell was a very astute businessman. He came here, and he's truly a self-made man. He came here with one sloop. He built what became the largest towing company in the country. He also, again, was involved in everything. He was one of the few guys who had the foresight to, when the rails came around, he saw that the rails were going to overtake steamboat. Many of his competitors did not. So he was ahead of the game, and he started getting into the rails. He got into everything. We have to remember that, you know, Samuel Kirkendall now gets a lot, he's a lot more well-known, and he gets a lot more of the credit, but he really built on what Thomas Cornell made himself. We have to remember that there were, I think, 26 trains a day leaving Kingston Point to the Catskill Hotels and other places. At the turn of the century, up to 1 million people a year went through Kingston Point. This was an incredibly busy and important place, and it was that way because of Thomas Cornell. And while I read this book, really, about Thomas Cornell, you learn all about the dynamics of the family and about the company. And at the end of the book, I have to say, it's very sad. You're really pulling for this company, for Bill Spangleberger, to keep this going. And when we look at these pictures of these tugboats, each of them had a personality. And they, you know, you learn about each of them. But Thomas Cornell was an incredibly, incredibly important person. And we do still have some remnants of his company here. The steelhouse is part of his, that building was one of the Cornell machine shops. The Millen's Steel Building, which I guess is now the old Millen's Steel, I guess they've moved, but that still has in the front Cornell Steamboat Company. The Cornell Steamboat offices were located at the bottom of Broadway. If you went all the way down, now you can see out into the river by the Mariner's Harbor, but right at the end of that, you would have run right into the Cornell offices, which were apparently beautiful offices. Each office was done differently. The marble fireplace, each one was done with a different kind of wood. So these were beautiful things. And he was an incredibly, incredibly important person. But I highly recommend this book because it really does take you through what he did. I mean, the man came here as a young man in 1837. By the time he dies in 1890, he has really created a monstrous company that controlled almost every industry here. So again, it's good that we are recognizing him. And if you do get a chance to go to Montrepose Cemetery, there is the showpiece of that cemetery, which is a beautiful place and a very important place. If you walk through, you'll see some of the most prominent people in Kingston's history, including Thomas Chambers is buried there. But the centerpiece of that cemetery is the Cornell Kirkendall Memorial. It's absolutely beautiful if you get a chance. And we're going to be doing a presentation in the spring. Ed Ford, our own Kingston historian, will be doing a presentation. We may be doing it there because it does need some work. But if you get a chance, go down. Check out some of these places. Check out some of the old buildings. Where his house was on Wirtz Avenue, I had been told that back in the day, the really wealthy people, the way they competed, much like the incredibly wealthy people do today, they each want their yacht to be a few feet bigger than the next guy. Well, what they did then was they looked for very unusual and large pieces of bluestone for their doorstep. And I was told that there's a large purple piece of bluestone in front of the steps for Thomas Cornell's house, which again, the steps are still there. The house is gone, but I did walk by there. There is a purplish large bluestone stop there, so you might want to check that out. But
Bill Spangenberg, who lived in Woodstock for many years, built a house there, and he had a piece of stone that was bigger than this picture, and he had it in his backyard, and it's about half this, this proportion, about half this piece, and it came from one of the Cornell buildings that was demolished, and
So
of course he couldn't move it when he moved here to Rhinebeck.
It sure shows how we've changed how we're able to spend our money. I do want to tell you about some upcoming events. Next month, we're going back to the third Friday of the month. January 18th is going to be, the subject will be Colonel George Chandler, who is the namesake of our own Colonel Chandler Drive, the shortest interstate route in the United States. But Colonel George Chandler is the founder and the first superintendent of the New York State Police. He lived on East Chester Street. He came up with everything for the state police, including the colors, the lavender ties, and lavender and gray. There are two stories of how that came about. I will let the presenter, who is Major Robin Benziger, let you know. He really redid law enforcement. The changes that he made, which were radical at the time, are now standard operating procedures in every law enforcement agency in the world. Including wearing your weapon outside of your uniform. That was an incredibly radical move and caused quite a stir when he did that. But that is going to be January 18th, 2013. Oh, he also is the inventor of herringbone parking, which we all owe very much to, although we don't know it. But Robin Benziger is going to be doing that. And February 15th, we are going to be doing a presentation on Ezra Fitch. Ed Ford, again, the Kingston City historian, will be doing that, so we hope you'll join us. Before we leave, I do want to thank a few people, because it's not easy to put on these presentations. And I want to thank Stuart Murray. He was wonderful to be able to do this. I have to say, technology is wonderful. I found him through Amazon.com, believe it or not. There was a link to contact the author. When I sent him an email just stating, what Kingston's buried treasures was, what we were trying to do, and I got an immediate response, and he said, absolutely.
Wait a second, I'm trying to get out of
it. No. He was more than willing to do it, and all of our speakers, this has been wonderful.
And it's because I couldn't find Barry Thomas.
Well, we appreciate it, and all the speakers that we've had, it says a lot about our community and the history here, that everybody who we've asked to do presentations has said, absolutely, we'd love to do it. And we're the beneficiaries of their years of research. So I'd like to again thank you, Stuart. The Senate House allows us to have the presentations here in the Vanderlyn Gallery. This is the largest collection of Vanderlyn pictures in existence. They are actually closed for the season. They opened this up for us, so we appreciate that. The Kingston Buried Treasures Committee, which is Ed Ford. Nina Postopak is not here. Ann Gordon, Tom Hafe is our alderman. Ann is a Ulster County historian. She is here. Joe Tantillo. Joe also does all the visual media. He puts together our flyers that you've seen and you may get. Again, if anybody wants, I'll have a form up here. I'll be happy to email you each flyer as they come in. If you signed up last month, you don't have to. I'll continue to send that to you. We also have a Facebook page now, thanks to Joe. It's, I guess, Facebook/ Kingston's Buried Treasures. Bob Rizzo films these for us, and if you want a copy of the presentation, you can get in touch with him. Bob is a great professional, worked many, many years at NBC, so we're lucky to have him. And he'll also be replaying this next week on the Esopus Community TV, Channel 23. I want to thank the people who really publicized this. We have Hugh Reynolds from the Kingston Times, who is here at every single event we have. He meets with the speakers and puts a spread in the Kingston Times. So, Hugh, you've done a great job for us. We really appreciate it. Jillian Fisher sends out an email constantly. She's always adding our information in there. We want to thank her. Kingston Happenings always has been extremely helpful to us. Ulster County Tourism, Walt Maxwell and Kingston Community Radio, they also publicize our events. Friends of Historic Kingston, Walt Wachowski, who was a past speaker here on George Sharp, he's actually been taking our information and putting it on various Facebook pages, and all of you. We thank all of you for being here. We thank all of you for spreading the word, and we hope that you can continue and join us. And if you have any ideas of subjects that you'd like to see in the future, please let us know. We'd be happy to do it, because there are some wonderful, wonderful people that have kind of gone off our collective radar, that have had great contributions, not only to our community, but to our state, our nation, and the world. And we're trying to recognize them and bring them back. So again, we thank you. Stuart, thank you. We thank everybody else. And again, have a wonderful holiday. We hope to see you in January.